First of all, if I'm a guard and I hear a potential robot muttering to himself about, I don't want to kill anybody again, I'm shooting them.
Yeah, I've met Walmart greeters with less patience than these guys.
Hi, folks. This is Lewis Hurfman, the original Peter Abernathy. Hell is empty and all the devils are here on the Shadow TV Westworld podcast with Roger, Gene, and Big D.
Welcome back to Shat on TV Westworld, the unofficial podcast companion piece to the hit HBO show Westworld. I'm one of your hosts, Gene Lyons, and alongside me is my co-host, Big D, Dick Ebert.
Good evening.
Roger Roper and Carrie Gross could not be here with us tonight. This is our deep dive edition where we look back on this week's episode of Westworld and provide our thoughts and analysis after having a day to digest it. Big D, you've been chomping at the bit to talk about this episode. I gotta know, what do you think?
Well, first off, yesterday sucked, okay, because I was fired up, ready to go, notes in, we're about to record, and Zencastr, which is the service we use to record, crashes, so I'm sitting here stranded alone in Orlando, unable to record.
Yeah, it was a bit of a surprise. We were ready to go, Carrie and I had our notes in, it was going to be the typical three-person Instacast, and we had a lot to say about it. But I think you, perhaps, out of the three of us, had the most to say about it and had put in some interesting notes. So I was excited to hear what you had to say, and then no Big D.
Oh, I know. It was terrible. So yeah, I did say, my first take on it was, I said, I was going to say I felt like Ralphie and his brother in A Christmas Story on Christmas Day. You know, I got all the presents. I ripped them open. It was great. And then I just pass out under the tree with my brother while my parents are sitting there watching. It's like Thanksgiving, you know, with a really good turkey, but you end up just getting everything. You're like, oh my God, I get some cranberries, I get some stuffing, some corn, some mashed potatoes. And it's all great while I'm shoving it in my mouth. But then I just sat there like, ugh, that was too much.
Well, luckily, we're still able to put out the shortest Instacast in history. People already have commented on YouTube and on Twitter that they were impressed with the brevity, or disappointed by the brevity, I guess, of the Instacast. Hey, that's Gene Lyons style, guys. But we do have a deep dive for you today, covering several topics. We'll try to get it in an hour or so. We're going to go over the Valley Beyond, what we know about it, the Farnold, the Ford-Arnold convert. Some people are saying Fernarnold. I think it's a bit much, guys. Let's keep it a little bit brief. We're also going to talk about the developing relationship between Maeve and Sizemore, and also some of the nagging problems that we had with season two. It's been great overall. We're still fans of the show, but there is a voice emerging among viewers and us at the podcast. So just some little things that are kind of nagging at us.
Yeah, and when I say that, I said I thought it was Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving's yummy. You know, I liked at the end thinking back upon it. Now it's a day later, but I just wish I'd stretched it out a bit. You know, a little turkey today, some stuffing tomorrow. I think it was so much that they packed into this episode that when we go to some of the problems, I'll address it. I think you could have spread it out and could have made Thanksgiving last a little longer than just one day.
So that might be a bit presumptive, though. I was thinking about this, and one of the things I really liked about episode 7 was that they set everybody back on the same page, right? So they're basically like, look, we got all these disparate theories going all over the place. Let's get back to something that's concrete, something that's real, something that you can hold on to. And that's exactly what I think the show was missing. Part of the reason I think that they're losing viewers is the fact that nobody knows what stable ground is, right? It's like you're getting seasick from all the moving pieces. And it was nice to have something solid to hold on to.
I'll be interested to see going forward, because remember, they released the first 5 episodes as screeners to some of the the professional reviewers out there. So that was kind of set in stone before the season, debuted. I'll be interested to see if they possibly shifted some of the back end around after the early episodes came in. And like you said, the complaints were people were getting a little bit lost because it seemed really dense with a lot of information that it was almost like it was a hectic reset, that it didn't feel as natural as season 1's reveals.
So let's get into these topics. If you haven't listened to the podcast before, this is the deep dive. So we're going to go in depth on a few buckets of ideas from the episode. On Friday, we'll have the Telegraph, where you can write in host@shatontv.com and share your ideas on this, the deep dive. And of course, this is following on the heels of Sunday's Instacast, where we just kind of had our instant reaction for 17 minutes. So before we even get into any of it, I want to send a shout out to Vince Lane, who's one of our listeners who wrote in to kind of give us a little bit of a French lesson.
Yeah, the traditional definition that everybody's been going with, and he already warns us right off the bat. He said, les écorches? He said, and we should try it with a French accent. Did that sound somewhat correct?
Yeah, so I was saying, so my first take on it, I said, les écorches. And then I remembered that if there's an E at the beginning of the second word, then you pronounce the S at the end of the first word. So it's les écorches. But then it's actually, you want to, it's the accents fall on the A and the A. So it's les écorches. Les écorches.
The French accent there helps. So Vince said, I thought I'd better send a quick French lesson to help you with the title of episode 7. The phrase does indeed literally translate into those who have been skinned, but it's commonly used also to refer to people who are tortured and damaged. Not necessarily literally skinned alive, tortured and damaged, but this certainly feels an apt adjective to describe Bernard, Peter Abernathy, and Maeve, amongst others, in this episode. So it's not just the traditional definition of being flayed, but it's also just someone who's damaged, and it seems apt for this episode in the season so far. So thanks, Vince, for sending in that correct French translation.
Les écorches.
Oh, that's perfect.
All right, so there were so many revelations in this episode, and it's hard to pick one that's more important than any of the other. So let's just start with the Valley Beyond. What do we know?
Well, it's been one of the big mysteries all season, and I was happy listening to the Instacast that you started to touch on it. So throughout the day, I was messaging you back and forth. I was like, okay, here's kind of an idea of where I see this is going. It was nice to see that you were on the same page. And I don't want to feel like it's obvious, but are we on to something with where we think we're going?
I think they gave us enough to chew on with this to give us an idea of what it is that they're looking for. So the Valley Beyond, again, we mentioned that people thought it could be an escape or maybe a myth, kind of like the land before time. Like there's this place where you can go and it's pastoral and it's heavenly. Essentially, it's where the hosts want to go. And one big clue that we get, we mentioned on the Instacast, is Dolores says to Charlotte Hale, she says, I can promise you this, your chances at eternity will die in that valley and all the souls you've gathered there. So it seems that this would be a gathering place for, if you think of a soul in the scientific sense or the digital sense, this would be where perhaps human essences, human personalities and identities are being stored.
Right. She says the souls that you've collected. That would imply that Delos has already been collecting human participants in their immortality, you know, whatever their secret program was, that because they haven't perfected the Jim Delos body transfer, this hasn't stopped them from collecting them in a virtual state. I want to call them, I'm going to say, you know, it's a human transfer to a control unit. So just to simplify it, let's say an HCU. So this is where you're taking a human and you're transferring them into a digital state. That this currently only works in a VR environment. So the James Delos component was only to then transfer it back where they failed. It looks like part one of their secret mission was a success.
Right, and that matches up with Ford's explanation that, quote, every piece of information in the world has been backed up, copied, except the human mind. And I love that line, the last piece of analog technology in a digital world.
Well, we now have also, finally, a location, an exact location. We've theorized for the last few episodes that the Valley Beyond could be in reference to that flooded valley where the hosts are seen in the premiere episode. And that's confirmed in this episode that Charlotte, even though you question whether this is what was said, but Bernard reveals while he's being interrogated by Charlotte that Peter Abernathy's control unit is being held in Sector 16, Zone 4. So this is the location they've referenced before. It's the mysterious bay, the body of water, where the hosts are dead floating. So I think it's where can confidently say that there is some form of secret facility at that location, unless Dolores maybe just fired Peter Abernathy's control unit into the water. But I think it's more likely that there is some form of facility hidden under the water.
And I think it's important to note that if this Valley Beyond does exist, what's chiefly different between it and the Cradle is that the Cradle, if you go in there, it looks like Westworld, right? It looks like the Old West, right? But the Valley Beyond, if it's a human construct of it, would be completely different.
Yeah, and we've seen in the Cradle that it's a virtual environment that lets the hosts in a familiar environment run upon their daily loops, their normal routines, so they never hit the shock of becoming aware or rejecting their environment. So if the hosts of Westworld and the Cradle need old-timey, Old West, they need their normal loops through Sweetwater, you know, Dolores and Peter Abernathy out in the farm working on the cattle. Dr. Ford's comment, which just seems that everything in the world has been backed up, takes on a new meaning that they've created a full-blown backed-up VR version for these HCUs or, you know, human control unit transfers. And they might not even know that they're in a virtual holding state.
Right. And this seems a little far-fetched or a little out there, but think about, you know, Raj and I play The Division. We try to get you to play it for a little while. It didn't really take, but on Xbox. And for that game, they basically mapped out Manhattan. They said, okay, we're going to give you this environment to play in, and we're going to map every street, every building. We're going to make that construct, and you play inside of Manhattan, and it's, you know, it's very faithful to it. And that's today for a video game. So if you imagine the full technical suite that Delos has at its disposal, mapping out the entire world, you would have no idea if you were a copy, and you would have no idea it wasn't the real world.
And she makes it sound like there is more than a few. You know, Charlotte says, you know, all those souls. I'm expecting that we're going to see something on the size of the Cradle or even more. Imagine if we walk into a facility that's laid out very similarly with those arms that are used to hold the pearls, you know, the actual, the center, the core of the control units. Imagine if we walk in there and it's like the Matrix where there's thousands and thousands of these. I think it would blow people away. I think it would be that surprise wow factor that people are expecting for the season.
Right. And that expands the possibilities of what Delos is trying to do, right? So first we thought it could be a future world thing where they're just trying to clone people and send them out in the world for nefarious purposes. It could be the fact that, you know, they mention an evolutionary leap. Charlotte Hale mentions that, you know, and not everybody's going to be on board. But essentially the idea being that if you were trying to take all the negative aspects of humanity out of the human, right, the violent tendencies, the underhandedness, all the undesirable traits that a person might have, you could, you know, in their HCU version, you could also clean them up a little bit, maybe change them a bit. And so it could be that they are not only trying to keep people alive in a virtual state, but also maybe, as Ford says, write an original tune.
And I always question, why is Dr. Ford driving William to this same destination? It's not for his, you know, this game isn't designed for him like he believes it. Because at this point, Ford is beyond running the park or designing a narrative, no matter how much or how important a guest William is. William has to serve a purpose for Ford's ultimate goal, which is now bigger than the park. So in that, it led me to the thought that the Valley Beyond could be that location we were discussing. But literally, it could also mean that the Valley Beyond refers to the outside world, that it's a logical reading of the phrase to imply that the Valley Beyond is the real world. It's the landscape beyond Westworld and Shogun World, and that William might be the key to somehow opening that. Because right now, while you remain in the park as Data, unless you can get out of the island and onto some larger network, you're always going to be in danger of being deleted.
And one final point I think that we should make clear is that we wondered how it was that that Bernard or Arnold and Dolores were on mainland China. Some parts of it didn't seem to add up. The visit to the house, the way she was in the room with Logan and Angela, but then seemingly wasn't seen. How all that played out. And again, if you have a Valley Beyond and you believe it's a virtual environment, then Dolores could have been taken there as sort of prep or for some other purpose for training. And so that could, she could have actually never left Westworld, but just think that she has. And I think some of that is backed up by the there's some sort of a linchpin there between the house in mainland China and the house that Bernard sees when he's with Ford inside the cradle, right? It's the same architecture.
Yeah, and one of my favorite parts of this episode was the way that they visually represented the Bernard Dr. Ford hybrid, that they used the reflection in the windows, the way he's seeing him in the room. And it triggered me to think back. Remember the scene where Dolores and Arnold are prepping for the presentation? Old Dr. Ford walks into the room and we see him in the reflection of the window. It reminded me very much of this scene. So there's a possibility that this was a real world, or a let's whatever you want to call it, the human transfer version of the cradle, that this was a practice run within the cradle for the humans where they were testing out, because we know that they boil down what people's drivers are, that they wanted to shape the presentation for Logan to be as perfect as it needed to be. And when they do that run, it is, I mean, I work in marketing. That presentation was a home run. It was perfect. They hit every single point that they needed with Logan. There was no way they could lose. And it almost, to me, seemed as though it was rehearsed. That was too perfect. They had to have either had some inside knowledge or ran through it maybe 300 times to see what presentation would hit that nerve with him. Don't you think it would be interesting at the end if, like, the cradle, which is the CR4DL, broke down for something, I mean, something like maybe like a created reality for digital life forms, and that the human version was like a created reality for human life forms?
Well, people have already emailed in their thoughts, and maybe we'll slip a couple of those into the Telegraph about what Cradle could stand for. And they're all very believable, but we've also had really great ones about what Arnold could stand for, what Bernard could stand for. So, yeah, there's definitely a reveal to be had there as to what the four is all about. Maybe they're just really hip.
Or maybe there's more than four cradles. Maybe there's, you know, Cradle, which would be the CR3DL.
Right. And Cradoodle. So you mentioned, Big D, that you love the visual representation of Farnold on screen. Let's talk a little bit more about that relationship between Ford and Arnold and how that works. They did a really dramatic move where Bernard is inside the cradle and Ford puts his hand like over the lens, which, by the way, if you know anybody with a camcorder, please don't do that to them. It's really rude. But they, you know, he does that. And then suddenly, you know, Bernard is coming out of the cradle and Ford is essentially inside his head. Let's talk a little bit about what the significance of that is and also how much power Ford has in this relationship.
Yeah. So do you like Farnold? Can we go with Farnold?
I think Fernarnold, I'm reversing now. I think Fernarnold is more accurate because you've got a Ford in there and a Bernard and maybe an Arnold.
Well, you know, I struggled.
You want to leave Bernie out.
I struggled for the first half of the season with Bernard. You want me to say Fernarnold? I'm setting myself up for hate mail.
All right. But Farnold's fine.
I'm going to go with Farnold. That's what I'm going to stay with here about. But yeah, so the reveal is, like we mentioned earlier, is that in the cradle or in the digital VR world, that the control units and the host hybrid or the host don't degrade. So do we all kind of, in setting up what we think the parameters are for this, that Ford, now that he's out and he's being carried around in Bernard, that the clock has started on him degrading?
I don't think so. We've seen before now that Dolores has had a voice in her head, who she's also visualized and seen in front of her. We saw that with Bernard in season one, and then she realized it was her voice all along, sort of thing. I think that this isn't necessarily a hybrid recreation of a mentality, of an identity, but rather it is just an imprint into a personality, right? There's a program running inside of Bernard. And I think that's supported by the fact that later in the episode, really toward the end, when Charlotte Hale kind of brings him to do diagnostics in the lab, they say that he's essentially querying his own mind, that there's a lot of activity going on there, that his brain's under siege. I think that's the battle between Ford and Bernard inside his head.
I don't know that I totally agree with that. Ford was obviously hiding out in the cradle. You know, Bernard printed out the control unit. They put it into the host that they were printing underneath the cottage. They introduce him to, you know, roll out at the gala the new narrative. He shoots himself. That whole time, Ford was hiding in the cradle to help Arnold and the hosts in the revolution by screwing with the network, by being the bug in all the systems. He only leaves because he knows that that environment's no longer safe. If the creators of the show try to now tell us that, yes, we understand that there's a small window of time that you can survive in the real world. If Dr. Ford was a real human, it was based on the HCU, a human transfer, they have to stay with those same rules. You can't establish that and then go around changing it.
But I think we're talking cognitive plateau versus just the ability for something to exist. So I agree with that.
I think that he's going to crash out. That Dr. Ford, if you start getting him past 20, 30 days, he's going to start to degrade and start to hit that plateau.
So this is basically turning into the thing? He's got to jump to another body or something?
No, they can't.
Or he's got to get into a virtual environment quickly.
Yes, that right now Bernard is just a vessel to transport him. It's only a means of getting him into whatever the new human cradle that we're calling it, that you can't transfer because the amount of data. You know, that's a comical scene where they have the tech who's like, I can't just transfer. This is a lot of data. You know, we struggle to transfer a 2 gig movie to a flash drive. They're trying to, you know, shift an entire host. So I think Bernard is just a means to get him into the new cradle. And if you don't get him there in a certain time, I think there's a chance that Ford will start to go mad.
That's interesting because we generally attribute higher aspirations to Ford, thinking that he is following a much more significant calling, a much more philosophically sophisticated ideal, and maybe he's just trying to survive.
Yeah, at this point, he has no other option. And one of the interesting tips they give us to this symbiotic relationship between Ford and Bernard is that Ford, even though he has the ability to take control, you know, we saw it with the hand up when Ford suggests to Bernard, pick up the gun, shoot the guard. And Bernard's like, no, I don't want to kill anybody. And first of all, if I'm a guard and I hear a potential robot host muttering to himself about, I don't want to kill anybody again, I'm shooting them.
Yeah, I've met Walmart greeters with less patience than these guys.
Yeah, I don't want to kill anybody. What'd you say? I don't want to shoot anybody. Huh? What'd you say? Yeah, so Bernard, obviously, because he's much like Teddy, he's a kind soul, he doesn't want to shoot this guy. So Carrie in the Instacast had mentioned Ford's comment, I'll take over so you don't feel the blame for what's about to happen. I took that as it was the immediate murder of that guard that Ford knew. Because remember, he is now he's kind of latched on. He's now in there with Bernard. If something bad happens to Bernard and Bernard doesn't make it to the cradle to transfer Ford to another safe reality, he's going to die as well. So as long as Ford can allow Bernard to have some form of free will and it doesn't threaten both of them, he seems okay to let him go.
And this brings to question what's been going on in Bernard's head in several scenes. When he's, you know, staring off or when he's bugging out or whatever, that could be at any given time, as long as it's after Ford's been, you know, implanted into his head, that could actually just be that conversation that's going on. Now, how fast that conversation processes, again, we're talking about a digital space there. Those conversations could be split seconds.
Yeah, go back to the premiere where Bernard is standing on the beach with the QA and with Strand. And we were always trying to decipher, what did he say? Did he say, I killed them, he killed them? It would make sense now if we see another recollection to that scene from Bernard's perspective, that Dr. Ford is standing there on the beach and Bernard isn't responding so much to Strand's question as it is to making a comment to Ford, you made me kill them. You made me do this.
If we see a flashback scene where Bernard is strangling a tiger, I'm going to be really, really disappointed in the show. One thing that I was having a conversation with King B about the way these conversations are depicted, and I could see a cynical person watching this show thinking, why is it two guys talking to each other? That's not really the way it would work in the head, you know, or why when Dolores is being probed and being questioned, why is she imagining herself having a conversation with Bernard and then with herself? And again, this is the most artistic and effective way to do it, is to put it in human terms and to really try to depict what's going on in their head. Because the alternative would be the person delivering some sort of soliloquy, which would be awkward, or some sort of a graphic representation a la American Gods of, like, you know, high-tech stuff going on in Bernard's head. And I like the fact that it just looks like a conversation. A few subtle tricks, you know, the reflections like you mentioned, but nothing overboard. You're keeping it, it looks like, it's almost like a stage drama, you know, and I really appreciate that.
Yeah, and I want to kind of end this section on questions that I still have, or some things that don't sit well with me. The whole time that Ford's in his head, and they're in the command center, and you have that beautiful, I mean, it's one of my favorite shots or one of my favorite set pieces from Westworld, both seasons, is when Beethoven's Symphony Number 7 is playing and you have the slow-mo and the gunfire with it's lighting up his face as he's standing watching the chaos. He finally gets to the control unit and he's going to deactivate all of the park's systems. He mentions to Ford, so is this your plan? You're going to allow Dolores now off the leash? This will end in her killing everybody. Ford, you know, reassures Bernard, no, this isn't my story. This is your story. Does he mean Bernard the character or hosts? This is the host's story.
I think he's got to mean that this is the host's story because he is at times completely overriding Bernard's controls. And he says to Bernard, the reason why, you know, as when they're in the cradle, he says, I don't think you have it in you. Like, you don't have what it takes to survive. I'm going to help you, essentially. I'm going to move you. And I think he means you, Bernard, don't have what it takes to lead the hosts or to facilitate the hosts succeeding. So I do believe that the story is one of evolution for an entire race.
Yeah. And one other takeaway I had in the powers that this new combination carries, Dr. Ford in Bernard is able to still control systems, physical systems, because he shuts down the lighting in the hallway in sequence to eventually leave that guard in the dark. Do we believe that means now that the Farnold can still somehow reach through maybe the mesh network and control the physical components of the park around him?
I mean, that would be odd too, because Elsie says that everything is back to normal, right? When Bernard comes out of the system, she's like, everything is back to normal. And so it kind of matches up with that timeline of when things started going haywire. It was Ford was introduced, and when Ford comes out of it, I thought that would be the end to that. But you do see that the lights go out right on cue. So it seems like he does have that capability, but it could just be a coincidence.
Yeah, and especially that Bernard had just shut down all the systems. So they have to explain this power. You can't just, you know, wave your hand. There's nothing to see here. They should be able to give us the ground rules. What are, because already we're confused. How many gunshots does it take to kill a host? You know, is the host, now that the cradle is destroyed, if they get shot and they die, but their control unit isn't destroyed, can you still resurrect them? Do you need to destroy a control unit? For everything that this episode answered as far as plot, they need to do some world building and give us some ground rules. Because otherwise, I'm not going to believe them that they say now hosts, if they die, they're really dead. So I would like to know what, you know, Farnold's powers are or how you kill them.
Well, thankfully, we got 3 episodes to go in this season to figure it all out. This episode was definitely a Bernard-heavy episode, but there was a little bit of Maeve and Sizemore sprinkled in there. And I'd like to talk about their friendship, and it seemed to give us a reason to care about everything that happened in Shogun World.
Yeah, it sounds a bit preposterous, and I had been lamenting the fact that we spent an episode and a half just to reinforce the fact that Dolores' love for her daughter, and she needed to realize that everyone has the right to choose their own fate. I would like it more if this... I mean, we can call it a friendship now, can't we?
I think it's a friendship, maybe a partnership, a relationship.
Yeah, but I mean, let's go back to the beginning of season 2 and let's see where we started off. Because Sizemore and Maeve have always had a contentious relationship. So in the premiere episode of this season, Maeve comes in and rescues Sizemore from the cannibal character that he had created for his narrative. What was it? Blood red on the... Do you remember what his narrative was?
Something on the Red River.
Yeah. I think it was something like Blood on the Red River, whatever his cheesy, his narrative that got shot down was. But they start off at gunpoint. He's being forced to help Maeve go after a daughter, even though he's reassuring her, it's not real. This isn't, you know, what you feel for her isn't something legitimate. It's programmed. So he starts off as a hostage.
Right. And I noticed, I think several people actually noticed that in the last, in episode 6 and 7, you see Sizemore, Felix, Sylvester, they've all got guns at this point. Like, they're just carrying pistols around, and Maeve doesn't seem to really care about it. She's really putting a lot of trust in these characters and really considering them part of the team.
Yeah, and from that situation where they start off in season two, the last episode is a complete reversal. Sizemore is no longer he's not a prisoner. He doesn't need to be there helping. He's been free. He got the communicator. He went and got the QA team. And sadly, they pull in right when Maeve is trying to, you know, she's having her one shining moment. She's about to theoretically kill her nemesis and tormentor, the man in black. And for Lee to come in with the QA team, shoot her up, have the daughter ripped away by Ghost Nation, it looks, if you watch Lee's reaction, he feels like he's betrayed her. And he immediately feels it, and he says, no, 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 to one of the guards. Don't shoot her. Don't shoot her. She's not like the others. He immediately feels like he wants to save her, and that he doesn't have to save her at this point.
As a side note, I think we can establish now that Ghost Nation are the cuddliest hosts in the park.
They're nice.
They jump out, arms outstretched, just hugs. It's no tomahawk chopping.
A little hug. But is this a Stockholm syndrome? It can't be. They haven't been together long enough for Sizemore to have a sympathetic feeling or relationship with his captors, is it?
I mean, if you think of it from this perspective, Sizemore, beyond all the things that he is a writer. He is a fiction writer. He is a creator of tales, and this is his creation. There is a sense of ownership there. And as he sees Maeve develop, I think that he's frankly impressed. And, you know, maybe even in love with Maeve. And so it's an interesting development between those two characters. Believable, I don't know, but you do seem to think that, you know, think about how much more likable Sizemore is now from season one.
Yeah. And remember Sizemore's revelation that the character of Hector was based somewhat on himself or who he wanted to be. And if Maeve now has some feelings for Hector, maybe there is some core kernel of the character that she likes. But I think this is now a friendship. They're helping each other, not out of being forced to. That it's a choice. And if that's the case, this relationship is the first of its kind in Westworld or the world. It's a friendship between human and host that's based on some kind of mutual understanding rather than a means to an end.
Right. And this is very different from other relationships we see in the show. You see Ford, he's obsessed with this idea of evolution, of advancing the narrative, of pushing forward, always pushing the boundaries. Dolores, on the other hand, has a degree of sentimentality, has a degree of revenge. That's the Dolores and the Wyatt conflicting in there. But with Maeve, it seems to be all about choice. And there is a certain irony or a certain poetry, I guess, with the fact that she is literally paired up with the guy who negated choice, that was all about pre-writing your script. And here you see that, you know, perhaps he is seeing the possibility in the free choice.
Yeah, and I'm already looking back on how I felt about the two episodes spent in Shogun World. And if this turns out to be that this human host relationship, or that some kind of an understanding between the two could develop into an understanding going forward, you know, this doesn't have to be Terminator 2, where it's, you know, the machines or the humans, that there could be some situation where they can both coexist. And going back in that, I think it's the end of episode 5, where Maeve genuinely thanks Lee for the first time, there's a little look in Lee's face that this might be the first time anybody, human or host, has ever thanked him. And I would like to think that the 50 minutes we spent would make that possible, because I'm not questioning whether their friendship is possible. It's not like that sleazy QA guy, you know, getting a hard on trying to, you know, let Angela get close to him. That seems ridiculous. Here, I think a friendship could exist.
That was a grenade, Big D. It was a grenade in his pants.
He thought she was grabbing for something else.
So moving from one of the most despicable characters in Westworld to one of the most beloved, I want to take a second to say possibly farewell to Peter Abernathy.
Do I need at this point to start playing background music of I will remember you?
I think that's fine. I think you could do that.
Okay, I'll do that.
Do you want to go with that? Okay. So we first saw him in season one playing the rancher who loved his daughter. That was his prime motivation. He was brave. He was the face of that Western ruggedness with those piercing blue eyes. Was kind enough to record our podcast intro, do an interview with us, and had some of the most gripping scenes alongside Sir Anthony Hopkins. Peter Abernathy is everything we loved about this show, and I really hope he's not gone. But it does seem that he has met his end by getting his head cut open by a bone saw at the hands of his own daughter. Although we never actually see his head cut open. Do you think there's any chance that Peter's still alive?
I think anything is possible, but we were talking before we recorded. You were a little upset that they didn't show it. Come on. They're not afraid to do it because it's the gratuitous violence. We saw two episodes ago where a character essentially beheads in one of the most violent scenes in Westworld history, the Shogun's head. So they're not afraid to show the violence, but we love Peter. If you saw Dolores taking that bone saw and just cutting his head in half, how could we ever look at her any other way than despise her?
I just thought it was odd that she had the control unit in hand. It had a little bit of blood on it, but we never actually saw it happen. Wait, and I do.
Did you want to see it?
Yeah, I wanted to see it. But I also wanted to see Coughlin's head get smashed in by Teddy.
Yes, but that's different.
I wanted to see the bloody pulp of it.
That's different.
I liked him too.
Oh, come on. We knew him for like, what, 20 minutes? Lewis Hertham is my digital dad. If I had a daddy, you know, in the digital world, I want to come out on the porch. He's having a cup of coffee. Talk about blue tongue. He's great. He's perfect. I do not want to see his head cut open.
But if you do have to go out, you got to go out with Shakespeare. And so to get back to that point, he did quote Romeo and Juliet with the one fire burns out another's burning, one pain is lessened by another's anguish. And that line ends with, which did not appear in Westworld, but take thou some new infection to thy eye and the rank poison of the old will die. Basically, they're consoling Romeo and saying, hey, you'll fall in love again. Find something, a fire that burns brighter, whatever. I saw that as Peter using those words, and Lewis Hertham did say he uses Shakespeare to convey Peter's thoughts to Dolores, that Peter was acknowledging that Dolores has a new mission, fallen in love with something else. And I wondered if also it was sort of a metaphor for with man's obsession with becoming a new species versus clinging to the old, right? And so I saw it as him giving permission to Dolores in his own way of saying, this new thing, you need to go after it, and it'll burn brighter than I ever did. And I thought that was a really poetic way to say goodbye without doing the hammy, you know, I'll always love you and always remember me.
I love you, baby. Yeah,
I love you, baby.
Yeah, he made a sacrifice. It was a nice way for him to go out. I don't think we're going to see him again, but I feel like now I have to make an in memoriam, you know, like they do at the Academy Awards for Peter Abernathy, because he's been with us since day one as a podcast and as a fan of the show, where we can string together some video of the happiest, like Lewis on the porch smiling at Dolores, drinking a cup of coffee. So I'm making a promise. I'm going to say it here. By Saturday, I'm going to create a Lewis Hertham in memoriam, little video montage set to Sarah McLachlan's I Will Remember You. I want to do that to pay homage to Lewis and the character.
I'm just going to binge watch Longmire, I think is going to be my thing.
No, I can't include clips from other shows. Okay. No, I'll be hunting down, you know, Murder, She Wrote episodes and 2015 Toyota commercials.
Well, anyway, I hope we do see you again, Lewis Hertham, on Westworld. Hey, Anthony Hopkins is back. I'd like to see you back too. Maybe season three will be a retro season and we get to see tons of you.
Well, that's, you got to remember, that with all the flashbacks we see, simply because Peter is no longer with us, that does not remove the possibility of seeing long stretches of him in future flashbacks.
I hope somewhere, Peter, you're in the cradle smiling on that porch in that rocking chair. But we do have some problems with season two. And before we close out, I'd like to get to those. For me, it was, you know, I've kind of been a critic of the multiple time frames on season two. I feel like sometimes it's gimmicky in the sense that a story can be told chronologically and still be very powerful. And this time frame is so compact that it seems like we're not trying to span, you know, generations here. Most of season two is in a very, you know, about 2 week window. And so I thought it might be better to tell it that way. And honestly, I mentioned this on the Instacast, it gets really hairy when you're doing action scenes, throwing multiple time frames in.
Yeah, and I don't want to say like it's like problems, because I still love the show, but there's it seems like we created a monster as fans, that we were all about the mystery and keeping, you know, the collective research together, and, you know, what's the overall going on, instead of just watching it. So we forced Nolan and Joy to add a style and format that maybe naturally didn't work the best for the show. Because the multiple timelines, as I can see, is only to maintain the mystery of, you know, that Ford is inside the cradle, or keeping us wondering which Bernard are we seeing. But a lot of times that comes at the cost of the overall story. In this episode, there's moments where we're starting to wonder, is Dolores going to take the bone saw and kill Charlotte Hale? But of course, we know that doesn't happen because we know Charlotte's alive in the future situation. So sometimes the timeline jumping actually took away from the suspense of the episodes.
I was thinking of the train scene when they run the train into the mesa, and how cool that would have been from a perspective of, you'd kind of, you knew that they were loading up the train for something, and then everybody's doing their thing in the mesa, and suddenly there's this explosion, you know, and with Phil tooting the hole, with Phil tooting the whistle.
Whoa, tooting the hole? What was Phil doing in the train?
tooting the whistle.
Okay, much better. Yeah. But also things like, in all the trailers we saw, the hidden room with the four or five Bernards, why did they have to show that right up front? That took away, again, some of the suspense of wondering who's in there, that reveal. We, as, you know, as watchers, we already knew it, but it's an in-world shock and surprise. I wish they hadn't shown that. So showing some too much information, I don't think that helped the plot or the progress of the show.
Yeah, if you can imagine season one, if during one of the trailers we saw Bernard going, what door? Like, it would have been like, you know, it would have been a total giveaway.
Exactly.
And yeah, I feel like we haven't had that wah moment in this season. I think the reveal of the cradle with Ford coming back was the closest to that, but it wasn't jaw-dropping. In season one, I had straight-up shock in certain episodes.
Yeah, and I don't need everything to be a big reveal or a reversal or a twist I didn't see. I enjoy a quality show told fairly straightforward. Look at what Game of Thrones does, right? There's a mystery in there still with some timelines of, you know, the White Walkers, about potential, you know, how Bran has interacted with them with time jumps and what's the origin of the White Walkers. But they do it in a way that doesn't affect the overall show's flow. I hope that this episode in season two is more of a reset. That they're lining things up. Yes, we have to merge season one, which was a mystery and it was a big reveal. I don't want that for five seasons. And the numbers show it. You know, the numbers are down. And I think that's because unless you have a PhD in Westworld, unless you're studying it and you're rewatching it and you're, like us, drawing out timelines, a normal viewer isn't going to enjoy it as much as more a linear traditional storytelling structure.
I'm glad you brought up Game of Thrones, because I was thinking about another aspect of this show that may not be as strong as it could be, and that's the way that they're playing fast and loose with mortality. So I know that part of being a host is effectively being immortal, but it's also happening with humans too, where you think somebody is gone, but they're not necessarily gone. I think Ford is a good example of that. And I remember watching Game of Thrones and spoiler alert, if you haven't seen Game of Thrones season one, you can just fast forward about a minute. But when Ned gets his head chopped off and you're like, no, like that can't be it, right? Like the something's going to save him, or maybe it's just a dream sequence. And you're like, no. And I thought of Deadwood was another great example of that. Deadwood, again, spoiler alert, fast forward about 10 seconds. When Wild Bill gets shot and killed and you're like, no way, that can't be it, right? Like over nothing, he just gets shot. Can't even defend himself. It's bullshit. And in this show, I feel like nobody important dies.
And I think that goes back to world building issues. And I'm trying to think of the entire... Okay, let's go back. I'm trying to think of over the now 17 episodes of Westworld. Have I ever truly feared for a character's life? And I haven't, because even when Dr. Ford is shot at the end of season one, when he's presenting at the gala's new narrative... Right away, everyone in the room starts saying, oh, is he back? Was that really him? Is it a host? They need to lay out what is the ground rules. And I'm hoping they did that last episode with there is true weight now to the decisions that the hosts make that are life or death. There's no more backups. So if you get killed, which I'm assuming is your control unit is destroyed, there's no bringing you back. But if you shoot up Maeve with 15 high-powered automatic rifle rounds, some 7.62 to the belly, does that mean you can still walk it off? Can I adjust you with my tablet? They need to do better to reassure us that what we're seeing on screen, there's true weight, and then we'll fear for the characters we love.
Right. So I think Angela is a goner. That's for sure. We see Clem get shot. Again, you don't know. Like, I'm like, should I be sad? Is she okay? Like, I don't know.
Again, I'm remembering back, there's a trailer where it looks like Clementine is on horseback, like riding straight at the camera, and there's the QA in buggies behind her. We haven't seen that scene yet. I don't know how that could be a flashback. So right away, I'm thinking in my head, I think I've already seen Clem. I think she could walk it off.
So before you say, oh, these guys just hate the show and write in and tell us how wrong we are, I do want to point out that I wanted to balance this out with some of the things that really impressed me about season two, what I'm really grateful for from the show. And for me, we've had these dramatic dialogues, both between the man in black and Emily, and also between Peter Abernathy and Dolores. Several of these pairings, Ford and Bernard, with amazing performances by these actors. The backstories being filled in have been very rich. I feel like I know these people. I feel like their backstories are real and palpable, and I care about them. The battle scenes have been exciting, if not tactically proficient. There have been very convincing special effects. That explosion was amazing. Some of the gunshots in this show, like if you go back and watch the effect they use on when a bullet passes through a body, it's incredible. It looks real, even in slow motion. And again, this could all just be, if we believe that this is a 5-season show, seasons 1 and 2 could just be the setup for something much bigger. And we're getting nitpicky on the small picture when the big picture is going to be something fascinating.
And I think we're nitpicky because 99% of everything is so good. On The Walking Dead, I loved the show. I had read all the comics up until about maybe even season 3, where it just, the nitpicking became harder to do because my expectations of the show were so much less. I didn't expect them to pull off things that would surprise me or that they were actually paying attention to detail. In this show, I still have 100% faith that everything means something. And a perfect example is that, as I mentioned, how much I loved the Beethoven piece, which overlays with the, you know, the flashing of light on Bernard's face, Dr. Ford leaning against the red wall. Enough that I would go and actually look up Beethoven Symphony No. 7, that I was thinking, hey, this song has to be put in place here to mean something. I wouldn't do that unless I had faith in the storytellers. And again, was I surprised that I felt there is a tie to it, that they didn't just pick it because it's a cool piece of music? But Symphony No. 7 was composed from 1811 to 1812 while Beethoven was recovering from an illness in the spa town of Teplice. And the work was dedicated, in what he said in the premiere, that Beethoven actually addressed the audience and said, "We are moved by nothing but pure patriotism and the joyful sacrifice of our powers for those who have sacrificed so much for us." I got to believe that they put this song in the scene of hosts making sacrifices for the cause, whereas other shows, I would just think they put it in because it's cool. So I still have faith in the show that they're head and shoulders above everything else on TV.
And again, it wasn't forced. In that scene, it looked beautiful. It matched perfectly. The speed, the composition of the shots. I mean, it is art on the screen, and I am grateful for it. So I hope that nobody takes us as knocking on the show. We're just saying, at least I'm just saying, that compared to when I see Westworld at its best, I think these are a few of the things that just are hindering it being a perfect show.
Yeah, and I listened to a few other Westworld podcasts, and a lot of them are just tearing every single part of the show apart, and I don't get it. Are you forgetting what else is on TV? Compare this to almost anything else. What? Seriously, what are you comparing it to that your problem is one bad scene of the QA force getting too close to a robot? People are stupid. Let's not forget that, right? So take a step back. Enjoy the show for what it is. It is a work of art, and it's a labor of love for everyone involved, including us.
Yeah, but the thing is, when you are HBO's flagship show, heavy is the head that wears the crown, man. Like, there is a lot of expectation. If this show was on Stars or TBS or the CW, I think it would be...
I want to see a version of this on CW. Somebody please do an edit, like a trailer for a CW version of the show.
Bernard's Cradle, it's going to be called. Speaking of Bernard, the one thing I wanted to touch on before we close, if we have time, is I was completely remiss in not mentioning Bernard's flashbacks at the end of this episode during the Instacast. That probably would have got me over 20 minutes. There is a lot in there. It is dense. And I was surprised that very few people are talking about it today.
Well, I see your list here in front of me, and I want to sit back and let you bask in the glow of your research. So walk us through here. I'll let you talk us through, and I'll try to limit interruptions, because I think breaking it down, that few seconds we see and the repetitive fast frames, there's a lot of hidden stuff in there, so I'll let you just run through this.
Right. So I will preface this by saying I'm not sure what it all means. I've got some ideas, but I think it's really up to you guys to help us piece this together. Again, writing into host@shatontv.com and let us know what you think about this. But basically, I think we were so taken by the submachine gun firing, the muzzle flash, and Ford's face, and Bernard's face, and Farnold's face, that we didn't stop to see the memories that he's seeing just before Charlotte Hale brings Bernard back online for interrogation. So the first thing we see after the machine guns shooting, the screen goes dark, and we see Dolores, and she's that exposed robotic skeleton, the early days Dolores, where her face is flesh, her shoulders are flesh, the rest of her is a robotic skeleton. She's seated on a diagnostic gurney in a laboratory, and she's talking to an all-black clad Bernard, or possibly Arnold. People have said that when you see the all black, it tends to be Arnold in a lab. And we hear a voiceover that says, "Bernard, Bernard, who am I?" But Dolores's mouth is not moving. So this might indicate that the communication is being done non-verbally, but he can still hear her, or it could just be a memory that's the audio superimposed over the image. As he takes her hand, the question is, "Who am I?" And we see a flashback to Charlie, Bernard's son, whether he's real or not, in the hospital holding the teddy bear. And Charlie says, "Dad." And Bernard says, "You're alive, Charlie." Now, I first heard it as, "You're a lie, Charlie." But I went back, turned on the closed captioning, which we know can be suspect. And it seems that he says, "You're alive, Charlie." Those three things combined might indicate that there is a bond that some people have guessed that between Charlie and Dolores, that he was either the inspiration or the cornerstone or some sort of a seed for Dolores to be spawned. The idea that you're alive and she asks, "Who am I?"
If I can jump in, one thing noticed here, this seems to sequentially track with the progress of their known relationship. It starts off at the earliest moments, and it almost seems like a logical progression in timeline.
No, absolutely. We then see Bernard in the China house with the evening gown Dolores, right? When Dolores supposedly went out into the real world is what we've been shown. And a Bernard voiceover, again, his mouth is not moving, asks, "Have you ever questioned the nature of your reality?" Then there's a voiceover from Ford that says, "And one fine day, perhaps we will actually resurrect the dead." And then another line from Ford separately, "In order to escape this place, you will need to suffer." again, referring to the loop. So, but he's also referring to a method of escape.
Yep, it's still following the timeline of their progression of the relationship. And it's funny that in a show that doesn't mind jumbling plot lines with what we see on screen, it seems that these flashbacks seem to follow a logical progression.
Well, hold on to your ass, Big D, because now it's getting jumbly. We next see Bernard in the QA buggy, and then he's standing at the sea filled with the bodies. Now he's not wearing the glasses anymore. So this is the late stage. This is beyond episode 7, Bernard. And again, this comes right after the line, in order to escape this place, you will need to suffer. We then see Bernard with Teresa Cullen as he's about to kill her, and the voices start to overlap. It gets to be a mess here. And here's where Teresa is pleading for her life. Then it cuts to Bernard's wife on the video conferencing screen, glitching with Ford's face embedded in her face, and then his son on a hospital bed. Bernard is now in all black again, so it could be Arnold at this point, not wearing glasses. And a voice in the background asks, "Do you ever wish you could forget?" And a separate voice answers, "No."
So do we think that these flashbacks aren't so much Bernard recalling his memories with Ford, or is he's questioning now that he has the final pieces of the puzzle? We've had the revelation at the, you know, from Ford in, well, yeah, through the timeline, because this is after Ford's in his head. So Ford, okay. So at this point, let's just, because I just walked through that in my head. At this point, Ford has already been in Bernard's head at some point.
Right.
We don't know if he's in there currently, correct?
When he's being interrogated by Charlotte Hale?
Yes.
Ford is in there.
Well, we don't know. He could have been taken out. So Ford,
oh, got it. Okay.
7 days in, Ford piggybacks onto Bernard. They then go off somewhere. They have 7 days where Ford could have been extracted from Bernard. So Bernard now, at this point, we would assume he has the knowledge that he learned from his time with Ford piggybacking. Could this be Bernard questioning every encounter he's had to judge? Because Ford has had no problem lying to him before, that he's questioning whether Ford is continuing to lie now.
Well, I think that there's a struggle going on, and it begins where, because at first the memories have clarity, and then right around the Teresa part is where the voices start overlapping and things get a little muddy. So I think you could see this as, this is where the most intervention has been done into his memory, or you could see this as an actual battle where this is where Ford is trying to force ideas into the head to mix up the messaging, right? So it could be that the Charlie memories, the China House memory, the ever question the nature of reality memory may be real, and then you start conflicting with the what's been put in his head, or it could be the other way around, but there is a battle going on there. And this is where it gets, you know, again, I think there's a very key question there where it says, do you ever wish you could forget? And I think it's in reference to what's being shown on the screen, which is his son in the hospital bed getting, you know, CPR. And so then it goes to Dolores, again, asking, who in the world am I? While she's raising the gun in her blue dress, this was presumably the gala scene. You don't see what she's aiming at.
Oh, blue dress was the first uprising. They do it in a way that makes you assume it's the shooting of Ford. And I thought about it as well, because they show a quick succession of Bernard laying on the ground shot. And I was like, whoa, hold on. Did we see Bernard shot at the gala? The way they edit it makes it seem like the same. But the blue dress is tied to the shot of Bernard on the ground with the bullet wound. That's from the first uprising.
But it's interesting because it's at night. She's in the blue dress at night.
Are you sure?
Whereas you see her, you see her in the daytime, you know, when she shoots Bernard or Arnold, I guess. So that's a bit confusing too. But again, this could be testament to the memories being mixed up. And then Bernard's voice asks, "Have you ever questioned the nature of reality?" And then Dolores fires the gun off screen. I mean, she fires the gun, but you don't know what she's pointing at, right? You don't see it. Next, you see Dolores in the blue dress without the gun, and she's next to like a diagnostic like lamp, like in a lab sort of setting, or maybe in a bunker. And she says, "I think there may be something wrong with this world," which I think is the conversation that she had before the gala.
Yeah, but I don't, because in the background, there's one of the, like the doctor's lamps, the lights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're never lit unless it's our letterbox version of the cradle. Every time they've been down there questioning, it's the room is dark. It's just, it's natural light. There's never that observation, high intensity light on. So that made me think that this was from the scene, that same time frame of the fidelity testing.
Got it. And then Fernarnold is standing in the hospital looking crushed at the unconscious body of his son who's receiving CPR. And his son's voice says, "Wake up." And then it cuts to Hale's voice saying, "Open your eyes. I know it's confusing separating your real memories from the ones you've been given, but it's the only way to remember, the only way to get to the truth."
Very interesting, because she's insinuating there that it's not having the QA and herself get to the truth of what's been going on and where Peter Abernathy is, as to having Bernard wake up to the fact of what the truth is, that Ford's motives are not as altruistic and as beneficial to all the hosts as he may lead Bernard to believe.
And that's exactly what I took from it, Big D. And then the tech is scanning his system, and he says about Bernard, he says his system is under siege. It's been querying itself for the last hour. It's like he's trying to debug his own head. And if you look at the screen, the tablet, it says heavy fragmentation with an image of Bernard's brain, essentially. So this could be taken a couple different ways. It could be that Bernard is trying to sort his own brain out, or it could be that if you believe Ford is in there doing work, that he is debugging the head himself. And yet another way to think about it is, if there is a vestige of Arnold in there, some bit of Arnold trying to do his own sorting, I think we can't figure that out without more evidence, but there's definitely a fight going on inside his head.
Yeah, and it could be simply that you've now implanted a secondary, not a narrative or a character. You have another being in his head, so maybe you would need to defragment that. I got to defragment my computer every week, and I don't do shit on it except for browse the internet and record a couple podcasts. I can't imagine what I would need to do if I had, Roger's brain transferred from analog to digital and put in my computer. Or it could simply be that they're using the defragmentation as a way to mask information from Hale and from the text.
Yeah, and if you're not familiar with the way computers work, basically the querying is the way that the computer is trying to access information from a database, right? So it's information searching.
Did the Ford transfer fix the indexing issues, or is he still suffering from it?
That's a good question, and I guess we'll find out.
Just wondering, is the defragmenting part of the system trying to fix the indexing issues that Bernard was suffering through all of his time with Elsie?
I mean, it could be. Definitely something is going on in there where he's trying to fix himself, but it is a question of whether he's doing it for himself or doing it at the behest of Charlotte Hale. She is asking him at this point, "You remember where it is, don't you?" And then what's interesting is if you look at the camera angle, she whispers something to Bernard, but she moves her head so that it's hidden behind his head so that Strand and the rest of them from outside the room can't see her mouth moving. And she whispers, "You remember where it is, don't you?" Then Strand says to Ashley Stubbs and the gang, "Prepare the phased array. The moment we get the key, we'll transmit our data to the satellite." And then he says, and then again, what you mentioned before, then they're going for a ride to the valley beyond. That's the area that's flooded with the bodies.
Okay, hold on here. Now, so I'm perfectly willing to believe that some 35-year-old greasy prior military mercenary on the QA team is willing to get next to a gorgeous sex robot than I am. This group of intelligent people not immediately saying, "Charlotte, are you fucking kidding me? This is definitely an ambush. Come on."
Right. Well, and Strance is very cocksure, and he's like, "All right, we're going to go. We're going to go." But I think it might be because it's a place where they've been before. Like Sector 16 Zone 4 is not, again, where the bodies all are and it's flooded. It's not on the outer reaches of the park or some hidden place. This is a place right in the middle of things. It's that West Valley.
But I don't care. You've now realized that this guy who you've been walking around with that you've presumed was a human has been a robot the whole time. Probably 80% of the QA has been butchered. It's like Jurassic Park. If 80% of the dinosaurs were killed, I'm still going to worry. Is there one or two dinosaurs out there? Let's think of every potential, defensive measure. He doesn't even take into consideration. Bernard is continuing the lie and leading us into a situation where he can eliminate us for good.
And that was the first thing I took from it, because it's also the way that, you know, this would be great if Charlotte is working to her own ends and wants to get away with things, leading people into a trap. You know, the way she says it to Bernard, tell them what you told me. And the fact that you don't see what he said the first time, which again, this is the second time now that we've seen Bernard whisper something to someone and we're like, ah, damn it, what did he say? You know, he whispered to Abernathy too, and we still don't know what he said to Abernathy in cold storage.
And Charlotte has perfectly good motivations that they've discussed in this very scene. The value of the key in the open market is immeasurable. Charlotte now, Delos is, they're going to be in trouble. They've got some wrongful death lawsuits coming if people, the board in there were human. Delos is in trouble. The QA is being decimated. Charlotte might be considering, I could make out better in this for myself in the end if I dispose of the QA and I'm the only one who holds the key.
All right, well, it remains to be seen. Again, we've got three episodes left. This one, to me, felt almost like a season finale, so I can't even imagine what they're going to do. Some people had tweeted that Westworld episode 7 equals Game of Thrones episode 9. Like, it's an episode 9 of Game of Thrones, basically. So it was huge, and then it might actually just be kind of a more subdued ending, but I think that there's still a few explosions left.
No, everything they've shown me this season leads me to believe that there's going to be some huge reveal at the end that will make all of us who follow the show in depth feel stupid that we missed something. But at the beginning, I said I felt like this was Thanksgiving. This episode definitely made me feel like a tryptophan high. Like, I just want to just kind of sit on the couch and just relax. And this was a lot to digest for one episode. And God forbid, we haven't even considered, what if the next three episodes are like this?
So are you saying that Arnold created Ford?
Fuck you, Roger.
That concludes this week's episode of Shat on TV Westworld. Be sure to follow us on social media and share with a friend. We're on Twitter, Snapchat, and Instagram at Shat on TV. Facebook, search for Shat on TV Podcasts. The website is shatontv.com. You can email us your ideas for The Telegraph, hosts@shatontv.com.
Hey, also don't forget, leave us a voicemail at 914-719-SHAT. And give you a little tip. The emails we truncate to pull out bits and pieces for time because we want to get as many people involved as possible. If you really want to have a good chance to get on to the Telegraph, leave us a relatively short voicemail. That way it's easier to get you in. Keep it concise. We can get a few people in. Couple sentences, but it's hard to get a voicemail in when it's 7 minutes long, and we've gotten them.
Or be a cast member.
Oh, hell yeah, do that. That'd be great.
All right, we're everywhere fine podcasts can be found, including iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, and YouTube. Be sure to subscribe, and if you stop by iTunes, please leave a review. That helps the podcast grow. Also, you can check out our sister podcast, Shat the Movies, to hear our reviews of 80s and 90s movies. Most recently, we did Showgirls. It's a tour de force. And coming up next on Shat the Movies, we'll be doing Terminator, the original, not starring Teddy, but starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. Also, if you tried to listen to the Lewis Hertham interview and had to stop because the pops and the cracks were driving you nuts, one of our listeners, Mark D., worked a bit of magic, a miracle, and went ahead and cleaned the whole thing up, removed all the pops and cracks. You can find that in the podcast feed on any of our podcast catchers. I highly encourage you to go back and listen to it, especially as a fitting farewell to one of our favorite Westworld actors, Lewis Hertham. So go back and listen to that.
Yep. Yeah. You can, anywhere where you get the podcast, I've replaced the file. So if you go back to your feed on iTunes and download it again, the clean version will be there. It's a piece of magic. I probably spent 3 or 4 hours trying to fix and remove it. We're not audio engineers, and it was nice that a listener like Mark D. could step up, because what he did was no short of a miracle, and we appreciate it. So go back and listen to it. It's great now.
Thanks, Mark. On behalf of my co-hosts, Big D, Dick Ebert, Roger Roper, and Kerry Gross, I'm Gene Lyons. Be sure to join us on Friday for our Westworld Telegraph. Thanks for listening, and as always, we'll see you at the Mesa.